In this episode, myself and Michael Ray Formston reminisce about our times working together at hen parties. Michael has been a performer, actor, singer, stripper, buff butler, naked life drawing model for over 10 years. And myself and Mike have done many buff butler jobs together. We've had some fun times, we've had some weird times. You're going to hear all about it in this episode. Also, our podcast sponsor is the European Hemp Company. Listeners of this podcast can get £10 off their CBD oil as well as free shipping when they use the code BenLowryPodcast at checkout. Go to europeanhempcompany.co.uk. As well as that, if you're interested in property investing, I'm a part of a joint venture group in South Wales, which is run by a coach and a mentor called Alex Louise Brown. If you're interested in finding out more about that, go to financialfreedomfilms.com. And if you're interested in being a guest on this podcast, go to benlowry.com/podcast guest. And if you're interested in being a sponsor, go to benlowry.com/sponsorship. Welcome to the podcast, Mike. How are you?
Yeah, not too bad, mate. Not too bad. Happy to be on you. All good.
I haven't seen you for a while. What have you been up to?
No, it's been a while, mate. I think the last job we did was that Bristol Butler job, wasn't it? Is that last time I saw you?
I don't know. I can't remember. We might as well tell our audience how we know each other because they won't know otherwise. So we know each other from doing hen party entertainment, basically.
That's correct, yeah.
How long have you been doing it?
Oh, I started off stripping when I was 21. So 11 years ago, I started that. And then the butlering came into it about 8 years ago, and then the life modeling sort of 6 to 7. So yeah, I've been doing it a long time, to be honest, mate. It doesn't feel that long, but yeah, I've been at it quite a while now, mate. I feel like an old veteran when it comes to these hen parties, you know.
Which one do you enjoy the most?
Probably the life modeling, just because you have more control over it, you have more banter with it, you know, you can actually speak to the girls, and yeah, it's I mean, stripping is there, you're in and out, aren't you? You know, 20 minutes and you're leaving. The butlering, you get abused more physically and verbally. But with the life modeling, no, it's the best of the bunch for me.
Yeah, I agree. Same here. It's much more relaxed. And I'm quite a talkative. I'm a conversational person anyway. So like the opportunity to stand there and like chat and interact and like is much more under control, isn't it? For me, that's
they're not pissed. Do you know what I mean? You know, if you're doing it in the afternoon, they've just started on the Prosecco, you know, they're not 6 to 7 bottles in. Do you know what I mean? So yeah, it's a completely different vibe compared to getting there at 8:30 at night and the place is rocking, you know.
I'm guessing you've probably done thousands.
Yeah, someone asked me this the other day, how many in total, and I honestly couldn't count. I'd say over 1,000, but that's the closest estimate. And without going back over diaries and doing the sums, I'd say, yeah, over 1,000 hen parties now.
Yeah.
So it's a fair few.
Same here, rough guesstimate, at least 1,000. And like, do you know what I find really interesting? It's like one group to the next can be so different. Do you find that?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, I don't want to slate any hen groups, but you get some who, and it usually depends on the bride. You get some who are quite muted. The bride has been maybe a little bit of a wallflower throughout her life. So she's just got a similar group of friends in terms of they're polite, they're lovely. You know, they're very safe with their humor. You know, and yeah, I don't want to say forgettable, but they don't stand out much, you know, which is fine. Like, it takes all sorts. And then you get some of the stories you hear, mate. And I'm just looking at this bride and she's there. Typically, you know, you probably find this as well. They don't tend to tuck up a bride like they would do on a stag scent, you know, a stag do. So the bride will be there. She's in a white dress. All the girls are dressed in black. She's got, you know, a veil on with bride to be and what have you. And she looks stunning and they're coming out with stories, mate. And you're just like, oh my word, you know? So, so yeah, you know, it takes all sorts, doesn't it? But
yeah,
very different.
I find it interesting as like a psychological study, like the difference in the way people behave. I mean, it's like you say, sometimes everyone's quiet, well-behaved, they're all very sort of civilized and considerate, and they're polite, and they ask you how you are, and you know, and all that kind of thing. And then the next group, everyone's screaming and talking over each other and shouting and playing with their phones, and it's like, wow, people are so different.
Yeah, and what I have noticed as well, again, I don't want to stereotype, but they tend to follow a theme. If the groups are from Essex, Liverpool or Wales, it tends to be a wilder group. 100%. And that's just something that I've known. And it just seems to be those three areas, you know. I've never encountered a Scouse group that's been quiet and reserved. You know, they've all been like, oh, get it off, lads, and all that sort of thing. And you're just like, well, okay, you know.
Same. Essex and South Wales. I've never noticed Liverpool. Maybe I haven't had them as much as you, but I say exactly the same. Essex and South Wales, they're fucking crazy. They get blind drunk as fast as they can, and they're like wild animals. But it's really noticeable, isn't it? Like, you get a group from Oxford or Southampton, it's different.
Definitely, like you said, Oxford, around the Cotswolds, where, you know what I mean, they're more reserved, they're quieter. But personally, I prefer the wilder groups. It tends to go quicker, you know, the time that you're there, because they're just up for a laugh, and I think you enjoy yourself more. You know, you have to take the lead less, and I do enjoy the wilder groups. You know, you tend to learn more things. You know, so absolutely.
What's been your experience? I mean, by the way, it wasn't my intention to kind of just focus on hen parties and like interrogate
mate.
But it's just because the conversation seems to be going that way. I'm just wondering, what's your experience been with agents? I mean, I'll just tell you my own thing to begin with. I started off doing live drawing for an agent. I won't say their name. It was an older couple, and the husband would always come and he'd do the tutoring, he'd do all the talking, and he'd just kind of stand there in silence, and it was pretty boring and pretty miserable. Yeah. And also the pay as well. I started off on such low fucking money, you know, like 30 quid I started off, like, you know, one job a month. It was just dismal, but that was all I knew. I didn't know any different at the time, you know. And that, you know, then I started picking up more agents and getting more busy, and the price sort of crept up a little bit, you know. And and eventually you start getting offered your own gigs and getting direct inquiries, don't you? So, like, what's that been like for you?
Similar, mate, to be honest. Yeah, I'm familiar with I think if it is the same people we're thinking about, I think I've worked for the same couple before, you know. And what I've noticed is, bar the money side of things, which you're absolutely spot on with, you know, it's some gigs will offer you £20 an hour. Now, £20 an hour sounds good compared to the minimum wage. I think the national minimum wage is like £8, isn't it? You know what I mean? But in terms of what they're charging these hen groups, you know, these hen dues for the total class, you know, you are getting, I don't use the word shafted, but, you know, you're not being paid a fair whack. And, once you're doing it with a tutor, so obviously the pay is split between the tutor and yourself, and the jobs typically that you do on your own. I prefer doing jobs on my own, you know, and just because you get paid a little bit more. You can, like you said, when those jobs come in direct, you know, you can charge what you want effectively. And I've had a similar experience. When it was starting out, it was more art based, but my opinion on hen dues, mate, all hen dues are fun based. You know, the girls are typically going for a weekend away, whether that be in Bath, Bristol, South Wales, the South Coast. And they want to have as much fun as possible.
Yeah.
You know, very rarely do you get a group to say, right, Mike, I really want to improve on my art skills.
Exactly.
Do you know what I mean?
And they're there to have a good time. You're there as entertainment. And the art and the drawing is just a novelty activity. No one's there to become a fucking professional drawer, are they? You know?
No. The way I think it's best to gauge your mate is if they're laughing, they're having a good time, and you're doing your job right. You know what I mean? So nobody's going to ring up and complain and said, oh, you know, we were having far too much fun. Not learning anywhere near enough. You know what I mean? I've never had that complaint before.
Yeah.
So, it has changed. It has changed a lot in the sort of, it's been about 5-6 years life drawing for hen parties has been around now, hasn't it? And it has. It's changed a lot in that time.
Yeah, so much easier when you do it on your own. Like, because when there's a tutor, they just get in the way. Like, you, because as an entertainer, you naturally want to chit chat and banter with the girls and have fun and make jokes and poke fun, you know. And like, if there's an art tutor there, instead of saying, right, now hold up your chalk and, like, you know, measure the length of the head, it just spoils the whole fucking thing, you know.
I agree, mate. Like I said, and don't get me wrong, some groups, they I suppose they do want to learn a little bit, but I find that that's the minority. The rest are there to see some guy, you know, get his chopper out, and it's naturally, mate, you're going to be on the flop. And you know what I mean? There's not many of us who look too great on the flop. I'm certainly not one of them. You know what I mean? And they're just here to have a laugh. If you've got a guy, and especially if you can take the mick out of yourself,
Yeah.
Then I find that it endears you to the group. And you tend to have, like I said, just them laughing, them having a good time, and you've got that hour or that 90 minutes to fill. And ideally, you want to be one of the things that they remember most about the weekend,
Yeah.
so
Do you know what? I find it quite therapeutic in a way, because you go into a group of people, you don't know any of them, you got no baggage, you got no drama, you don't know who's who or who's done what, and it's like you get a fresh chance just to meet people, have some fun, make friends. And there's something kind of cleansing about that. You know what I mean? You can leave your normal life behind, you can forget everything else that's going on. And I think it's been quite good for me psychologically,
I think the one thing, mate, is, and I can't imagine anybody to argue this, the confidence you gain from it. If people go on about how difficult jobs are, because some people are terrified when it comes to public speaking, aren't they? You know what I mean? And if you can imagine, it's public speaking. You can have a group from 10 to 35. Do you know what I mean? I think that's around the biggest group I've had, and you're doing it fully naked. Do you know what I mean? In terms of breaking down mental barriers and being comfortable with yourself, confidence levels, it is wicked for that. If you can do that, if you can talk to a group of women that you've never met before, completely in the nude, take control of the class, get them on site, there's an awful lot more that you can do. Do you know what I mean? In
Yeah,
terms of your capabilities.
totally. It's quite a lot of pressure in a way, isn't it? And like, if you can do that, because I sometimes pinch myself. I'm getting ready, getting changed, getting ready to go in, and I think to myself, there's 20 girls in there. They're all screaming. They're all blind drunk, and I couldn't give a fuck. I'm just gonna walk in there. I'm just gonna take control. We're gonna do what we got to do. Have fun, and it's nice to have that res to get to that kind of resilience, isn't it?
Yeah, mate. A few times I thought back to the careers advisor in school. Around sort of 14, 15, and they ask you what you want to do and stuff. Do you know what I mean? And I thought, if I'd have known back then what I'd end up doing. Do you know what I mean? It would have been a weird conversation with the careers advisor, but it's crazy. I mean, don't get me wrong, it's not a full-time job, at least it's not for me anyway. It's not busy enough for that. It's more like weekend work. But yeah, it's a pretty crazy job, and a lot of people say to me, I couldn't do that. I just couldn't do that. But once you've done it as many times as the likes of you and me have, mate, it's work, and you're just going to go there, you're going to have a laugh, and you don't care in terms of. You've got no hang-ups about your body. They're either going to like it or they're not going to like it. And if they don't like it, either way, it's tough, isn't it? You know what I mean? You're there, like I said, to lead that class. Make sure they have a good time. Make sure they leave that weekend thinking of it as, one of the highlights.
I actually recommend to anyone, if they get a chance to go and do naked life modeling for a normal art class, just give it a go, because it gets you past that point where you just stop caring. You just don't care about anyone looking at you. You kind of, and it makes you more self-conscious about your own, sorry, you know what I mean? It makes you more self-confident about your own body.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Like I said, the confidence levels, and you can't buy that confidence. Do you know what I mean? It comes from experience of doing it. And I was an insecure teenager. You know what I mean? And I started through drama. Being up on stage, doing the singing, the dancing, and stuff. Well, granted, it was in a chorus. I was never talented enough to do it solo. You cannot underestimate how important confidence is for an individual, I think. And like I said, the only way you get confident is by facing those fears. It's same as something like swimming. Terrified of water, you've got to get in the water. You know what I mean? And exactly the same with being in front of an audience, in front of a crowd. Like I said, singing and dancing, once you've done it a few times, you've got that confidence. Take it a step further, and if you're doing life modeling, even if it's for a proper art class, you know what I mean? That's scary the first time. The hen do's, they take it up another notch. Do you know what I mean? Because there's interaction involved. So it's you can't buy that confidence. I think it's key to an awful lot of people. And if more people were more confident, they'd be happier people, I think.
People often ask me, what's the craziest thing that's ever happened to you at a hen party? And to be perfectly honest, I'm a pretty placid guy. I'm not particularly wild. I'm conversational. I'm polite. I'm sort of a bit cheeky, but quite polite and charming. I'm not a kind of gregarious sort of wild man, really. And so nothing wild ever happens to me. I mean, there's been a few things here and there, but like, you don't have to go into details, but what's your experience been like?
All right, okay. Okay, well, let me tell the story first. Because I think, you know, the first part, you know, it sounds a bit wild and a bit out there. This wasn't with a life modeling class, because, like I said, they tend to be tamer than, you know, your stripping or your butlering. It was a butler gig, and there's two occasions that stand out in my mind. One, for all intents and purposes, was sexual assault. You know, there was you know, those breadsticks, the crispy ones. You know, you chuck them in a bit of it, not the French ones, not the 2-foot-long ones,
But the
the
ones with seeds
crunchy
on.
breads. But yeah, the crunchy breadsticks. You'll have a variety of dips. They're about, oh, I don't know,
Cheesy
8 to 10 inches
Twizzlers.
long. Do you get, you know what I mean?
Cheesy
So,
Twizzlers.
yeah, similar to that. Similar to
Right.
that. You know, and in a lot of these hen parties, you know, you get nibbles spread out, don't you? You know, a bowl of tortilla chips and what have you. Anyway, one of these girls, I had my back to her, and she was pissed up. You know, she'd had a few, and yeah, she took a couple of bites off this breadstick, and it had a bit of a jagged edge on it. And she took it upon herself to run up behind me and jab me in the ass with it. Now, mate, I don't want to go into too much detail here, but her aim was spot on. Do you know what I mean? And she hit the old sphincter, and I tell you something, mate, it's a shock of my life. You know, so I know, like I said, it was the jagged edge. It didn't have any dip on it, so it was dry. You know, and yeah, that was painful. So I did turn around. And I did say, "Oh, what the fuck are you doing?" You know what I mean? And told her, you know, give her a bit of a dressing down as much as I could. You don't want to turn the group against you. But in this day and age, thinking back on it, oh yeah, it was sexual assault. But I'm not. I had some pretty wild mates as a teenager growing up. You know what I mean? And a lot of things, mate. You know, you just sort of you don't care. You know, and that's it. You know, some people would potentially have phoned the police about that. You know, but at the end of the day, mate, it's just a hen do. They're pissed up. You know, it hasn't affected my psyche. It didn't physically damage me severely. Don't get me wrong. I was a little bit sore for a couple of days, like, but yeah, that would probably be the wildest thing that's happened. But again, I like I said, I don't want to play down sexual assault. You know what I mean? Because it's one of those subjects, especially these days.
No means no,
That's
Mike.
yeah, exactly. You know, absolutely. I completely agree with that. You know, and yeah, like I said, just, you know, her aim was true. You know, it was like fucking Robin Hood hitting that, splitting that arrow in half. Do you know what I mean? So, yeah.
Where do you reckon she gets that hand-eye coordination from?
Oh, mate, I don't know, but she'd make a mean squash player. Do you know what I mean? She'd be a devil, you know? So yeah, but I mean, like I said, I'm a laid-back individual. And I was like, oh, look, you know, there's no point in taking this to the police or anything. But that was a shock.
Yeah,
You
I
know,
had
that
a
was,
similar one. It wasn't up
yeah.
my arse as the case with you, but I had
Yeah.
a cupcake in my ear, and I mean, no, but the intention that the woman did it with, she was very aggressive and being really horrible. She was one of the aunties, and sometimes aunties feel like they got something to prove because like they're older, and she was just one of those people who's a bit vile, a bit horrible, a bit negative, a bit bolshy, bit just a not a nice person, and she was just being a pain in the ass, and she slammed this cupcake in my ear, and it was a similar situation. You know, it spoiled the mood. I just wanted to get out of there. I didn't want to make a scene, but it's like I just wrapped it up as quick as I could and got out of there. And but you know, the things like that are few and far between, but they
They
do
are.
happen.
They are. You know, it is pretty rare. And you know, when you said you get that, you know, the odd auntie and stuff, now and again, and it's not common, you do find an individual and they just want to rip into you in not a jokey banter way. Do you know what I mean? You know, if you get naked and stuff, oh, you know, cold, are you cold? That sort of thing. And you know, it's a bit cold in here and stuff. And then, you know, you tend to ignore it. And you know, you play along with it and be like, yeah, I'm freezing. You know what I mean? Or and then they've, oh, you know, well, you know, not as in as good nick as my hubby or my other half and stuff. You know what I mean? And they just tend to sort of give you a gentle line of abuse the entire time. And but the only way I deal with that, mate, is I remember that I'm just being paid for it. I've got an hour to 90 minutes to maybe 2 hours if it's a butler job. And at the end of that, I'm never going to see them again, you know? So, yeah, I don't tend to address it, but you do find those individuals. And yeah, you get slated for the duration, you know? But again, like you said, you wrap it up quick and you're out of there, you know? And, you know, the likes of, I think a lot of individuals who do our job is you're not sensitive. It's kind of water off a duck's back, really. So you
It's
just
all
let it
part and
go.
parcel, isn't it? Yeah, it's just
Yeah, absolutely.
so I've never done stripping. So How long's a routine? I've got no idea. What do you do? Like fireman outfit, that kind of thing?
Yeah, it's typically stereotypical. You know, you got fireman, policeman, officer, and a gentleman. You know, that sort of thing. What changed the stripping industry was Magic Mike coming out. You know, obviously Channing Tatum's a hell of a dancer. You know, it puts across the mental image that you get guys doing backflips and stuff. And don't get me wrong, some top end strippers, a lot of these guys that have worked for big companies like the Dream Boys or Adonis and stuff, I know that some of them are gymnastic and they can break dance, but they're few and far between. You know, if you can't do that, then you lend it towards a comedy strip, and that's what I do. In terms of duration, for a ladies' night, it might be a 20-minute slot. You know, when some guys that do it, they'll bring in things like fire eating and stuff, which isn't stripping, but it does bulk out the routine, you know. Or if it's a stripogram for a hen do, you're talking maybe 10 to 12 minutes.
What's
And
the difference?
again,
So the other routine's on stage, is it? Is that a ladies' night?
yeah, typically with your ladies' nights, you'll get them in maybe rugby clubs or sometimes even village halls. And if you're given a stage, you know, it's more of a show. Whereas, you know, like I said, with their Hindus and the stripograms, you know, it could be room in a pub, it could be a club, you know, it could be a private house, and it's literally you're talking a chair in the middle of the room, you know, so it's much more intimate and, like I said, less of a show.
And presumably, do you have music with that? So, like, do you take a sound
Yes.
system with you? Do you get, like, give it to one of the girls and say, take that in there and press play when I come in or something? Or...
I used to, but then I've had three sound systems have, you know, drinks spilled on them. And at 60, 70 quid a pop, it's expensive. Do you know what I mean? So I don't tend to use it anymore. But what I will do is I'll contact the group on the day, ask if there's a sound system at the venue, and typically we'll go with that. You know, I mean, 9 times out of 10, can you think of a hen do that doesn't have any music going on? Do you know what I mean? They've got their own sort of Bluetooth speakers and that, you know. So luckily, you don't have to walk in there with your own PA system or what have you. You know, you're pretty fortunate in the sense of the system will already be there, and if you've given enough time and enough prep, then you can use what they have. And even when it comes to the songs, mate, you know what I mean? I've got obviously a playlist on my phone, but you can typically go with whatever they've got playing. I mean, I've stripped to some absolutely garbage songs in the past, and in terms of, you know, not the best for stripping, you know. So it is a different sort of form of entertainment to obviously the butler in and the life drawer in.
Now,
But yeah.
how have you dealt with it? Have you always been just completely open and like everyone knows what you do, or have you like kept it private and secret and not told friends and family?
When I've done sort of things with TV, I went on Take Me Out a few years ago, and I actually said to them then, I said, I don't want to focus on the stripping. You know, they mentioned about life modeling, but only because at the time you don't want the, oh, he's a stripper, he fucking loves himself. Do you know what I mean? You didn't want to generate that sort of stereotype before they'd even had a chance to speak to you and you know, find out what you like. So yeah, there have been occasions where I've played it down. When it comes to dating, you have to be upfront and honest. You know, you can't keep that sort of, because some women are going to be fine with it, some women are going to be like, absolutely not. So you know, I don't want to waste the lady's time, I don't want to waste my time. But more so now, I'll just say, look, I'm an entertainer, you know, and I entertain at hen parties, and that can be in various states of undress, you know, and like I said, they can either fill in the blanks or they can ask me about it. So now I don't, you know, I don't tend to big it up, because some people do in terms of, oh yeah, I'm a stripper, and you know, well, I'm not that kind of guy. I'm quite happy to take the mick out of myself. Do you know what I mean? And yeah, so I was more reserved about it years ago, not so much now. But again, I want them to get to know me, and I just like having a laugh. I'm laid back. I don't really care about a lot of stuff, you know. And I'd rather them think that of me than think of this stripper that they've got in their mind, you know.
Same. It's not something that bothers me. I'm pretty open about everything, you know, because like if you're having, because you hear some stories about some guys and like they use a different name and they don't want photos taken and they don't want, and it's like, oh my God, like you might as well just not bother if you're that worried about it, you know.
Yeah, the only time I use a different name is with the stripping, because you can get some odd women, mate, who they have got a bit of a thing with when it comes to strippers, and they'll try and find you on Facebook, and that sort of thing, and message you. And it's weird, you know. I've noticed that a lot of guys that I'm friends with on Facebook, they've got a lot of the same women in common, you know, mutual friends in common, and these women just love everything they post and commenting on it and stuff. And I've spoken to a couple of them, and he's like, yeah, they, you know, I do get, they just want to chat, but they want to say to their mates that they've been chatting to a stripper. It's a bit of a weird thing. So with the stripping, a lot of them use stage names, but not with the butlering and the life modeling. You know, I'm quite happy to use my normal name, yeah, like, you know, and, yeah. But the problem is being called Mike, some people think I'm lying. You know, oh, is that your real name though, Mike? Is, you know, because the film and stuff, like, I promise I was born with this name, you know, give you my driving license if you want. But yeah, I don't tend to go in for the fake name stuff unless it is with regards to a ladies' night and stripping.
With agents, I find there's like two kinds. There's the ones that are just really easygoing. They just send you a text message. You just confirm or decline. And it's just simple as that. There's no faff. And then there's the ones that want you to sign a contract, and like, they don't want you to work for other people and all this kind of shit. And they've got all these terms. And if you do this, then that. And if you show up late and you're not allowed to give your phone number, and like, oh, fuck that, man. I can't be bothered with that.
No, exactly. I completely agree, mate. You know, I'm a little bit old school in that I'm quite happy to work for someone based on a trust basis, you know, because I'm not there for any other reason apart from getting paid. You know, I primarily see it as a job, and providing you get paid the money that you ask for, I can't see an issue with that. But like you said, there are some out there, and they'll send you across their contract or their do's and don'ts and that. And a lot of them are fairly straightforward. You know, you don't want to be sleazy with the girls. Turn up clean, turn up, you know, obviously after you've had a shower and that, try your best to turn up on time. But a lot of these places, mate, if you go in for some private house out in the Cotswolds, the sat nav doesn't always take you straight to the address, does it? You know what I mean? So providing that you can get there within a decent time instead of bang on, or, you know, some places I've had, they want me to arrive there half an hour early. And it's like, well, are you going to pay me for that half an hour early? No. Well, you know what I mean? It's a case of, yeah. So, so there are problems with it. But personally, I'm like yourself. I prefer to do it on a trust basis. You know, I work hard for you. You send me the work. You know, you pay me what you're supposed to pay me within a decent amount of time, and we're good. Yeah. And then that's how I prefer to work.
What kind of locations do you enjoy going to? Because I love the ones that are in the country, in like a big farmhouse or some converted barn in the middle of nowhere. And they're usually like big, nice, posh houses that have been done up to a high standard. And it just feels, I prefer that, you know?
Yeah, I completely the same, mate. You know, driving there is usually a more pleasant experience. Because like I said, you're going through the countryside, you can see some wicked stuff. And there's some lovely houses on the coast. And typically, these are houses that, if they're not the primary residents of the people that own it, so if the people aren't there, you get some rich people down in London who have got their country house, so they rent out to Hindus on the weekend, you know. And I mean, that's money making money, isn't it? You know, you can't fault them for doing it, because it's lucrative. But much like yourself, I prefer going to those private houses. And some of them, mate, the standard they finish to is incredible. Do you know what I mean? And I love seeing it. It's wicked.
Yeah. Oh, that'd be a great business to be in, isn't it? I mean, I'd love to get into that side of things.
Absolutely. And... Yeah. I think, you know, you're probably the same sort of opinion as me, mate. As you get older, you want money to sort of work for you, don't you? You know, and you're not going to be going around doing the Hindus when you're 50, 60. Do you know what I mean? It's a young man's game in that respect, isn't it? And you probably don't really want to, you know. You want to be getting a steady stream of income from doing less, I think it's fair to say, you know. So, but that's what I'd love to be doing anyway.
So what's going on with your acting then? Are you still doing that?
Yeah, I'm still doing the acting, mate. The acting, unfortunately, it's a game of, you don't know how busy you're going to be or not going to be. You know, you'll have an audition come through. And now, because I've been doing it that long, I am of the opinion, I had an audition through for Peaky Blinders. They sent me the scene, and it was myself, Tom Hardy, Cillian Murphy in it. And it's very easy to get excited, mate. But all you got to do is you send off your self-tape, which is what a lot of the casting agents want now. So you literally will take it with your iPhone instead of having to travel all the way down to London. And, you know, you forget about it then, because if you get it, great. If you don't, you don't, you know. And like I said, with the Peaky Blinders thing, it was like, Jesus, you know, that's a couple of big stars there, you know what I mean? But at the end of the day, you have to treat it like any other job, mate. I didn't get the part, you know. So, yeah, you don't put your hopes and dreams on it. You know, it's if I get work, great. If I don't, well, I don't, you know, and I've got multiple streams of income in terms of doing the hen parties, doing the acting. I do a bit of personal training as well. And yeah, it's just keeping the ball rolling. If acting happens, great. If it doesn't, that's great too, you know, that's fine, you know. So I just take it as it comes, to be honest, mate. And as long as it gives me a few stories and pays a few bills, then I'm happy with it.
Have you ever had a normal job?
A normal job? Yes. Different to yourself, because I'm pretty sure you never had a normal job. You've always worked for yourself.
Yeah,
you know, no, mate, I've had some shitty normal jobs, do you know what I mean? I've worked in catering, double glazing salesman, warehouse assistant, Chinese delivery driver, undertaker's assistant. You know what I mean? I've had some shitty jobs, mate. But again, if it gives you a story, and I think because I've worked a job for like £5 an hour, it keeps you honest, you know? I could end up going back to a job like that. Do you know what I mean? And yeah, I think for me anyway, it's made me more grounded in the sense of, if I was well paid all my life, perhaps it would give me far more of an ego, you know what I mean? And thinking you're worth a certain amount. But like I said, mate, I've done some shitty jobs, you know, but I'm glad for it. You know, it's like I said, it's taught me a couple of life lessons. And if you can pick up those life lessons without having to do them, then great. But I think for me, I needed to work in places like McDonald's and what have you, just to start you on the bottom rung of the ladder. And yeah, you know, just to add another trait to your personality in terms of, I'll never be too big for my boots, because I've done some shitty jobs.
What else do you spend your time doing besides the stuff we've already talked about?
Besides the stuff that we talked about, I'm well into my, I enjoy my gym work, you know, that I'm not, like I said, I'm not into bodybuilding, that, you know what I mean? I enjoy the process of it, but I'd never compete, you know. It's it becomes more of, I don't know what the correct word is, mate, but far more of a sacrifice, you know. So those diets are hard, and those guys that get up on stage, fair play to them, you know what I mean, because it takes a monumental level of work. But no, I enjoy my fitness. I enjoy my health. I enjoy my nutrition. I'm well into those. And yeah, my sport as well. I enjoy my boxing, even my WWE wrestling. I enjoy the theatrical side of that, you know what I mean? My quizzing as well. I've come so near yet so far when it comes to a couple of quiz shows, you know, on telly that I've applied for, but I haven't quite got the nod, you know. So just spending time with the family, mate. You know, I'm quite easily pleased. Seeing the world has become a big thing with me, but on a budget, you know, because it can be expensive if you let it run away with you. So last year I did 12 holidays in 12 months, and that was all on a budget, you know, and just to see if it could be done.
Where did you go?
Well, I started, the big ones would be Dubai and Thailand. Those are the ones that you couldn't really do on the cheap. But the ones I did manage to do on the cheap were Croatia, Rome, Prague, Switzerland. You know, I did Northern Ireland. I did Scotland as well, which, okay, not abroad. But like I said, I had to still fly there to get the destinations. I did Paris, you know. So it was wicked. And like I said, mate, just seeing the different cultures, experiencing that different part of the world. A couple of them I went on my own. A couple of them I went with friends, you know. But it was good. It was wicked. And going back to what we were saying about when you go to the houses in the country, you know, and you see that natural beauty and stuff, when you're seeing it in different countries, like I said, like Iceland is another one, you know, it's incredible, mate. It really is, you know. So I enjoy my travel. But just keeping busy and trying not to have too stressful a lifestyle, to be honest, because I don't believe the stress is good for us. So keep it minimal, keep myself healthy. And that's pretty much what I'm getting up to in my spare time away from work.
What's your long-term goals?
Long-term goals, you got the old cliche one of being happy. You know, I've got a son who's just turned one. I'm not with his mother, unfortunately, but I've obviously put a lot of time into being dad, you know. And ideally, I'd like to get to a stage where I'm working more from home, less travel. And in terms of financial, there's a coffee shop that I'm looking to open up. Like I said, I worked in catering for 7 years, it was, you know, and even though I enjoyed the job, the money was, like I said, £5 an hour, mate. Do you know what I mean? The money was, it was peanuts. But the passion I have for things like food and what have you, I'd like to put into that and see how that goes. Initially, I'd have to work, you know, work my ass off 70-hour weeks to get it going and get it running. But once it got to a stage where it had gained its reputation, busy enough, then I'd sort of start to step back a little bit from it, you know. And again, it's that multiple streams of income that I think is crucial, because putting all your eggs in one basket, if something were to go wrong, mate, and I know you're a fan of the multiple streams of income yourself, you know, you, just minimizing that risk when it comes to if you know, if your finances take a hit, you know, you want to be able to fall back on something else. So yeah, long term, like I said, be happy, be a good dad, get the coffee shop business going, and yeah, I'll have to hang up my G-string from the stripping, I think, sooner rather than later, you know, but I'll still keep on doing the life modeling. I think that's got a little bit of a longer shelf life on it, to be honest.
So what time frame are you thinking of the cafe? Like, are you looking for places now?
Yeah, I'm looking at locations now, and you know, I wouldn't want to compete with these big companies like Starbucks and Costa and stuff. You know, their branding is so strong. You know, people go to a Starbucks to go for a Starbucks. They don't, like, don't think which is the best coffee around. You know, they go because it's a Starbucks. And like I said, it's the same with going for a Domino's pizza. I worked in a pizza restaurant, and you know, people go for a Domino's. You know, so I wouldn't want to compete with those massive chains. So I'd probably keep it, initially at least anyway, keep it to South Wales ideally, and somewhere a little bit further away from these big companies. So if it wasn't to work, then you know, then it would be down to either a poor choice of location or my own lack of work ethic, and I'm hoping it's not going to be that latter, to be honest, mate. So yeah, I'll start it small. I might open up a couple, who knows, it depends how successful it is. But yeah, if it goes wrong, again, just minimize that risk. I don't want to bankrupt myself, you know, because it'd be bloody hard to build myself back up again from that. But
Which
yeah, we'll
area?
keep it South Wales. At the minute, I mean, I've got my nan who's based in the Rhondda Valleys, and she's based in Nelson. And again, that's a smaller company. I think once you go closer to Cardiff, you know, you've got some companies, prior, you know, private companies in Cardiff. Sorry, private coffee shops in Cardiff that are doing really well, but the rates in some of those arcades, you're talking £60,000 a year. And to go from zero with your little experience into signing though onto those sort of rates, that's fucking scary, to be honest, mate. So yeah, I'd rather want to, if I was ever to do that, I'd rather be safe in the knowledge that I know exactly what I'm doing, instead of thinking, right, if this goes tits up, then financially I'm going to be ruined for a while, you know. So yeah, so I'd probably keep it to the Rhondda Valley, I think.
Would you go into business with someone else, or would you rather keep it as your own thing?
I mean, never say never, but when it comes to, I think, unless you know you've got exactly the same ideas and share exactly the same, you know, opinions on how things should be done, I think it can be tricky doing it with somebody else. You know, we've all seen those stories, mate, of, you know, one person has left a business with, you know, with money that, well, they literally ran off with money. Do you know what I mean? So I suppose you don't want to open yourself up to that. But again, it would depend on the individual. It would depend on what scale, you know. If you're starting small, you know, you're not chucking £30,000 into something straight away, are you? You know, so yeah, so it can be done. Again, never say never. I think what I'm looking at the minute is doing it myself. But if an opportunity was to arise, then yeah, I'd definitely entertain it working with somebody else.
What angle are you going for? Like, what unique,
Like a USP.
yeah.
It's difficult with coffee because you can't say, oh, I want the best coffee around, you know, because it's subjective, isn't it? Some people like a smoother blend, some people like a stronger taste. Do you know what I mean? So you with coffee, it's difficult in the sense of what is your USP. So if it was to come to the, what mine would be to come to the actual shop itself, and I'd want the shop to be kind of a community hub, in the sense of, if I was to keep it to one of the smaller villages and towns in the Rhondda Valley, really sort of get myself involved with the local sports teams in terms of sponsoring it, and become entrenched in that community to begin with. The actual shop itself, it would depend on what you want to attract in terms of your customer base, because I mean, you typically get your old biddies, excuse the term, that would like to come for a quiet coffee, but then you've got your students that come in. Do you know what I mean? So in terms of the style of the venue and my USP, it's difficult, but you know, the loose parameters I've set myself would be quality, low cost, friendly environment, and like I said, doing a hell of a lot for the community, which would also work into my marketing side of things. So, you know, so yeah, so I'd start small and literally go from there.
Cool. Yeah, interesting. I was kind of imagining some scenario where somebody puts up the money, but you run it, and like you'd sort of you have some sort of share. You each have some share of the business or something like that.
Yeah, again, it's a possibility, mate, isn't it? You know what I mean? Providing that you have got exactly the same vision for the place. Again, on the honesty side of things, do you know what I mean? It's some people, they can talk very well in terms of having a passion for it, but their work ethic doesn't match that. And I think providing you're honest enough and you're not looking to shaft anybody else, because the business world can be a cutthroat world, mate, as you know what I mean? I know you've been in business a long time yourself, and yeah, it's I think it'd be about choosing the right partner for that. So yeah, again, never say never. It is something that I'd entertain. But again, it would depend completely on the individual.
Cool, sounds good. What are you up to today then?
Today, mate, I've had a morning full of work. I've had clients that I've been training in the gym and that, you know what I mean? So literally got in, speak to yourself. I've got the family coming over later on. I think I'll head down and see my nephew. He's only 3 months, you know what I mean? A bit of family time for tonight, and that's going to be my day. I've done my workout. I probably do a food shop at some point as well. And that'll be my day. So it's going to be a fairly easy one. What about yourself? Maybe you got any more podcasts doing, or have you got other
No,
plans?
not today, just our conversation and just general admin, just doing working on spreadsheets and emails and just
It's
all
got to
that
be
kind of
done, man.
thing.
It's never stops. Never
Yeah.
stops, does it? You know what I mean? So
Yeah.
no, it's got to be done. But yeah, but that is my day, mate.
Nice. Do you have a website or anything that you wanna shout out?
No, I don't have a website. I mean, I've got the classic Instagram and the Facebook, in the middle of starting a YouTube channel, but Instagram is on the mic with Mike, and yeah, that content's pretty loose to begin with. And when it comes to the YouTube stuff, I'll be doing two YouTube channels starting in the next couple of months. One will be focusing purely on boxing because I'm a massive boxing fan, and the second one will be going down the route of dating and general experiences that I've had that I'd advise other people on. So again, just laid back. And I wouldn't look to hit it too big to begin with, because I'm covering a broad range of topics, from how awkward it is losing your virginity to how you can see 12 countries in 12 months. Do you know what I mean? So yeah, just have fun with it and see where it goes in that respect. Work hard, and yeah, off we go. Because I think the YouTube format, it's worked for a lot of people in the last couple of years, isn't it? So I'll be looking to sort of explore that avenue and see where that takes me.
Nice. Awesome, Mike. Yeah, great stuff. Thanks for coming on
No
the
worries.
podcast.
No worries at all. Thanks for having me, Ben, mate. It's good to speak to you.
All right, I'll speak to you soon. Take care.
Take it easy, Ben. Thank you, mate.
Bye.
Ta-da.